There we go. Now it's recording.
It's recording now. Okay.
And see, that's how you get everybody in there.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll just make sure that that's out. You know, every now and then we'll take a look at it and make sure.
Hey,
I think
You need to go? Yeah, man. All right. We got the loader for fixing those rails. Should be here.
Thank you. Let's get started. Drive safely.
Well, we appreciate that.
We've come to order, work session October 12th, 2018.
First item on the agenda for the work session is the second read of the meeting procedures. We'll open a table for discussion on that.
Okay, we have a discussion on that.
Do you have anything laid out?
No, I wanted to hear from y'all what you wanted.
Okay.
Mr. Barton had indicated that he wanted something similar to what Barron County had with some loans. I heard from Mr. Jackson that he was a little concerned and wanted to have a discussion tonight about what type of limit we were going to have on public input. One thing that was discussed was whether or not to, if preferring residents and property owners, could you then also allow those folks more time than you did non-residents? One thing that I have researched, we can prefer, if we're going to set limits on time, we can prefer our residents and our property owners in terms of order. However, what you cannot do is give non-residents, non-property owners less time than the residents and property owners have. So it's going to have to be equal time. And then with regard to whether or not it's just a matter of policy that the mayor implements as the chair of the meeting or whether it's ordinance, your charter allows both. So whatever you all tell me you want, I can have either an ordinance or a resolution available to you all on Tuesday night.
Okay, we have questions.
Okay, all right. We have, like I said, in three different kinds of ordinance. We got a procedure, and then in 2016 we had some other information
policies.
Policies added. I would like to see that consolidated into the policy.
Okay.
The policy I read in up to, I guess, 2016, we had, it was not, wasn't any limits. Then we instituted 5 minutes. But that wasn't in the written procedure, that was an addition. And then we had the ordinances. I just want to kind of, in my opinion, and I know other people's got some questions up here tonight also, but I just wanted to consolidate and then we'll go with how the other people speak of how to get it written properly.
Okay. What time, I mean, there's been two times discussed. One is 2 minutes and one is 5 minutes. Is there some consensus as to what you all want in terms of time?
I don't think 2 minutes is fair. By the time you get up here to the podium and you hit the stopwatch for 2 minutes, and you introduce yourself, you say where your address is and what your motion is, there's 30 seconds. Now you got a minute and a half to speak on something, an issue or a topic that might be affecting our community. I don't think 2 minutes is fair at all. And I don't think it's really enforceable. If someone is addressing the mayor and the council and they're pointed and they're polite and I don't see any reason why we couldn't change that to 5 minutes and give them a reasonable amount of time.
The other thing, and this is important, I should have mentioned it before, is one thing that I'm going to strongly recommend against is that you all leading this either the chair or by a vote of the council as a whole to extend the time of a speaker. If you said, like, for instance, if you set 2 minutes, allowing another speaker to have additional time at your discretion, that's going to create First Amendment problems. Whatever time you all set, it's going to have to be enforced consistently across the board. There's not going to be opportunity. opportunity, or you're not going to be able to basically...
Exceptions.
Well, we had a politician, you know, for instance, he gave his little plug, I don't know, a little bit last year, he went for 12 or 15 minutes.
He was not in the community section of the agenda. He was on the agenda. That's a different animal. Let me talk for quick just a minute, if you would. We have had problems with people talking on subjects that didn't need to be talked on. There's been a lot of things that were going on. We want to limit the length of discussion as far as the total number of people. If we are going to have 10 minutes as far as the length of time we're going to have community input, and if we extend it to 5 minutes, then we're going to only have two people speak. If we say, no, let's not have a 10-minute limit, then we're going to be here all night. We're going to have 45-minute discussions. What people should do when they have input for the city is they need to talk to their representatives. They need to talk to the city council individually. They need to talk to the mayor individually. They can go to the city administrator and get things clarified. If somebody is concerned about the height of stop signs or something along that line, they don't need to come to the city council and expect to talk for long periods of time. If you go to a city council person or the mayor or multiple representatives and say, I have these concerns, the representatives, the council and the mayor could put a topic on the agenda if they feel that it's appropriate to be on the agenda. In which case, then that's not part of the community input section. We can have more discussions. But it's a, we have been in situations where people have spoke for 15 minutes at a time and those types of things, and we just don't need that. Your input is valued, but you can provide that input to the individual council people. Our phone numbers have evidently been put on the internet by an individual group. So, give us a call. Give us a call. Talk to us.
Okay. Anybody else?
Well, I would agree with Eddie, and I also agree with Dwight. We should have 5 minutes, and everybody should be treated equal.
For the 10-minute camp, or let them go all night?
Well, we don't know what happened here.
Read the... Would you read the procedure, that section? It's about middleways down. It talks about 10 to 20 minutes.
It says the ordinance that had been proposed said the remarks by any one person are limited to 2 minutes, and that's expanded by the presiding officer. Public comments should be limited to 10 minutes total. So that's what's proposed. That's not what's in the ordinance.
Okay, can you pull up the not the ordinance, but the procedure?
Right now, you all have a 20-minute limit on total on public comment. So you would allow 40 minutes.
Okay.
If they took the whole time.
Right, if they took the time. Go ahead and speak up, Al.
Is that 20 minutes per person?
No.
Total.
5 minutes per person. Per topic. 20 minutes total.
Okay.
Per topic.
Yeah.
Well, I think if we have 34 citizens, they come in here and they bring something that they feel we should listen. And I think we should listen to them. I mean, after all, that's what it's all about.
Okay. I think everybody's discussed it. Anybody else?
Well, Tommy, do y'all feel?
Well, I think it needs to be brought up during council meeting. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's the way you feel. I mean, if there's no more discussion, I mean, I just don't want to come in here. I don't want a table and wait another month.
Right.
Either we make a decision Tuesday night.
But I think they should get on the agenda and not raise the hand and just let everybody stand up and talk. If they're not on the agenda and the topic that they want to speak on, if it's not on there, then that's different.
And if it's not relevant, if it's just bull, it don't need to be. I mean, and Miles can know that when they come in. I mean, we just don't need, like you say, we don't need.
Let me get that clarified. Are you saying that they should be able to put their topic on the agenda? Or are you saying that it needs to be one of our topic items that they're allowed to talk about?
No, they need to put on there what they want to talk about. How else are we going to have it?
So we can have some more of the repetitive, month after month, same topic over and over again, just like we've been doing.
You don't have to be white there.
Mr. Jackson, to answer you, to be more precise, it's 20 minutes per topic, 30 minutes total.
Correct.
What the policy purpose says. This is something you all need to decide. The two close, the Barrow County where you sit and Oconee County next door, they both allow public comment only on items that are on the agenda.
And I'm agreeing with that, yes. It has to be relevant to the city. It just not coming here and things that we've bashed for 6 to 8 months and then continue bashing it for their own recognition. Just what we talk about. Some way we got to, if it's on the agenda, that's what we talk on that night. They come in and said they want to speak on that, they know what's on our agenda.
Well, the problem, and one thing that you cannot do, that you can't say, you can't have kind of a general, we'll listen to that particular topic for 4 months and then we're not going to listen to it anymore.
No.
That's a First Amendment problem.
So,
the way that under the First Amendment principles, you're basically either going to have to do it, like Betty says, where it's wide open, or what I seem to hear you saying is that it's going to be limited to what's on the agenda. On that particular point, there's really no middle ground.
Okay.
It's going to have to be one or the other.
Well, that's fine. I mean, you answered the question. That's what and there again, I'd like all three of our pieces of our ordinance, our procedure, and the amended part in December of 16 consolidated and hopefully go from there and everything will go pretty much.
I think that when you continue to discuss this right now, because this is a relatively large topic, and we're starting to get to the point where we're having disagreements by people that agree on other topics, and those types of things, you better start coming up with somewhat consensus.
Yeah, I mean, hey, that's what we're here for. I mean, I agree with Ariel. That we just need to sit down and take Betty's or mine and consolidate night, you know what, come back right for Monday, Tuesday night. Make a
I think we need to somewhat know what we'd like to.
I mean, is it consistent 5 minutes, what it was?
I agree, 5 minutes, 20 minutes, 20 okay. minutes per topic. And no, we can't restrict anybody from coming to our town and speaking. It's just...
As far as the topic,
in town, out of town, it doesn't matter. There's people in the audience right now who have business here in Statham who don't live here that need to speak to us. So I think we don't need to put any limitations on who can speak here because, you know, that's
So the question is, do we allow people to talk on any topic that they want?
It has to be on the agenda.
Put on the agenda by the city, or can anybody put their topic on the agenda?
Well, how is it set up now?
How are we doing that?
Right now, what it says is that it's only items that are on a published or amended agenda, but there's a provision for citizens to request to be placed on the agenda. So long as they do that by Thursday afternoon, then that's on the agenda, and that's what they need to do.
That's our procedure.
That's procedure, yeah.
And so what we're saying currently, if I want to say that I want to beat up so-and-so department or so-and-so whatever, as a citizen, I am free to spend 5 minutes ranting, and then my next friend can rant on the same subject, and then my next friend can rant on the same. Is that what you're saying?
Yes.
And that's the problem.
Is that the policy? But that has been the policy for the last X amount of years, correct? I mean, I'm just asking that because I'm 10 months in tonight, and I told Perry today I'm learning a lot. I've read the ordinance, I can't memorize every thing on ordinance and then find where it's been amended.
I do want to make sure that Mr. McCormick, the way that it works now is that if you are a resident or you own property, for instance, Mr. Lewis is here tonight. He owns a substantial amount of property in Statham, but he doesn't live here. But he would, regardless of whether he's here to talk about a zoning or not, he would fall within that group that would be committed to speak for non-residents, non-property owners.
Mike Rice is here. I've talked to all. The policy has worked. We issued 5 minutes in 16. That's my opinion now. If anybody else wants to speak up on that end right up there, Betty or has got anything else to put into it. I just want to iron this out before we go to the next subject because we got several tonight.
The last point that I really need for y'all to give me some consensus on is, do you want, in terms of speakers being able to address only things that are on the agenda, do you want that to be the agenda that is set by the mayor and council at the work session? Or do you want that to be a situation where someone can, before close the business on Thursday in the work session, ask to be placed on the agenda to address a particular topic? It used to be that way before the policy, after the institute policy, it was made specific that people could just show up and start talking.
That's what I want to do what the policy has well, and we have not abided by that. That totally. I'm just saying, I'd like to make sure that is the way it's done, and if that's, and make it work. And that's what I'm asking.
Okay.
City
Council.
Well, I think if they come in and
hit
on
that,
I hate to say it, they should be allowed to speak. If they got a problem, they need to address, and they come in here at proper time, sign up, then I think they should be allowed to speak. They're allowed to pay taxes, why not?
Normally, do the agenda, and we've been allowed 5 minutes. I don't see what we need to make any changes to it. That's my opinion. Just leave it like it is.
So in other words, there's been some desire for an ordinance council. I've had at least two council members coming in on an ordinance, so we can take the policy and we can put that into the terms of an ordinance.
Evidently, it's the consensus of the committee that they don't want to review.
They don't want what?
To revise the ordinance.
Okay.
So, whatever.
Well, you got the man Tuesday to read up on it, think about it, and we'll go from there.
Go ahead.
What I will have for you all on Tuesday night, and then you all, it's the first reading anyway. So, the second reading we did for the last one. I'll have, basically what I'm going to do is take the policy that we have, and I'm going to put that into the form of an order. And I will highlight the things that we've been talking about tonight in terms of the time limits, the time for topic, and the total time, and then whether it's on the agenda or not. So those are highlighted for you all to take a look at. And then we can make the changes that night if you all can agree. And we'll have the document ready to adopt on Tuesday night.
Okay.
So we're going to be adopting a new ordinance Tuesday night. Is that what?
No,
not. No, we're going to. She's doing the first read.
Okay.
So we
are doing the second read.
Procedurally, you all can adopt something on Tuesday.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Thanks for your work.
Okay.
Next item on the agenda is Professional Probation Services, Inc., the second addendum to the contract. It's in your packet, and Quincy is here to answer any questions.
Any questions on that?
Right now it's $35. It hasn't been raised since 2007. So they're asking them to bump it up $5 to $40. And it doesn't affect us. It's what they collect from the citation holders once they're put on probation through their collection services. But it's just their supervision fee that they charge the individual to monitor them with whatever probation requirements the judge can send them.
As far as what we're raising it to, it's comparable to the other cities?
Yes. The surrounding counties are currently at $40. Barrow County is the last one to be raised in their wider location where the office is. And so far, all the other municipalities in this area have already voted and it's been raised. The city of Auburn, Winder, that's one more thing.
Okay, any questions? Okay.
Next item is the first read annexation and rezoning of map parcel number XX126-050 from Ag to R1, and Mr. Rice is here to discuss that.
This is property out of Highway 211. Glenn Jackson was safe on the left side of the left hand. And 45.8 acres of it is already safe. From up this far, as the NHC is 14.84, which is adjacent to the total acres, which is 60 something to the city, which CWS is 45.8. And then later, they're subdivided in acreage and not a subdivision. Acreage lots, not 1 acre, 3 to 7 acres. But right now, this is annexing as a property.
Okay. All of that on the left side?
Yes, sir. Most of it's already there. It's from the, this is a gas line, that new subdivision, clearly that piece of that.
Any questions?
this. I came, I guess it's a year or so ago, we had an offer on the property, and we didn't go through. But coming back this time, Michelle, went through Michelle here to see him. His process is as good as any community I've ever been to do it, including Winder, where I'm from. And Hal Chetwood, that y'all, I guess, is subcontractor, whatever you call it, has done a tremendous job. The state might be proud of what they got there.
Thank you for that.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
It involves that property. The designer, somebody else's property, who? I'm talking about the people that was paid. He had 60 acres, going to the airport for 2 feet. There's an ankle here, somebody else had 3 feet.
Those are the fee schedule, that's part of the fee schedule that's in this agreement. Next on the agenda is the first read rezone of map parcels ST06A-088 and ST06A-088A from R1 to R2. Mr. Lewis is here to discuss.
Good, how are you? So I think it's a pretty straightforward proposal to rezone two pieces of property I own over on 8th Street from R1 to R2. I had a house there for a significant period of time. I've owned it since 2003, and the tenants set a fire and the house burned. So I just tore that house down. So in looking to rebuild it, it's just apparent that building a single family dwelling there is not going to generate cash and do what it needs to do. So I'm asking to rezone it so I can put a duplex, a nice property, a quality property to have some decent and respectable residential space. I also own the back piece, and there's a trailer on there, and I'd like to eventually tear that one down and put another duplex back there. I have a bearing manufacturing company here in the state, and I have a problem getting people here to get good workers, so it's just part of what I think I need to do to both help this area and help my business be able to continue to grow and employ more people.
So you own another business here?
I own six of the industrial buildings in the industrial park over here. So my bearing company here, Volution Incorporated, is in there. We have about two of those buildings, about 25,000 square feet. So we're manufacturing bearings, we're manufacturing special lubrication for bearings, so we're growing pretty significantly. And we've been there for 25 years, but only recently we started actually manufacturing specialty bearings, and we've got additional salespeople. So we're in a position of growth, like to remain here to stay. And although these two things aren't really related, they are from my approach to what needs to occur and what I think we need to have here instead, and so that I can have at least an opportunity for quality.
I have a question, and it might be Thomas who answers, or it might be you, I'm not sure. Right now, the access to the second house is through the first drive, the first element. And and if the property is ever split, you'll have to deal with easements and those types of things. Is that correct?
It's already two lots now.
But as far as the driving through the first lot to get to the second lot,
well, since it's under sole ownership, that's not a problem.
That's not a problem.
But Mr. Lewis does real estate work, so I think he ever sells the back line to make sure that there's an
access. The other question or concern is between the first property and the second property, it's a gravel drive. And, if we make it duplex, make it R2, does that need a concrete drive or a tarmac drive, or can it stay gravel?
There's nothing in the ordinance that requires it to be paved. council wanted to make that a condition of granting the rezoning, that's certainly a possibility.
And right now, we're just zoning the first property, is that right?
Yeah, I went ahead and applied for a rezoning for both properties, just so that I can
I mean, have you thought about that, Brian?
Oh, yeah, I want to upgrade and get the drive paved, and those are all things I want
to do. You do? Wouldn't object to us making it a specification?
I don't object to that at all. I don't want to improve the property and do it the right way.
Yeah, people wouldn't want to. No. They wouldn't pay as much for the run.
It would be more difficult to deal with it if it wasn't actually paved, so yes. And the problem is, you know, I just haven't really generated enough revenue out of that property over the years, and this is a great opportunity to do what needs to be done.
So you can start with the first part.
Yeah, I want to do the front. I'd like to go ahead and rezone it, but then I, you know, when I submit my building plans or whatever for the second piece, you know, I'm taking that as something I plan to do anyway.
So we could make it a specification.
You wouldn't object to a condition that before you were able to get a building permit for the property on 576, you could pay the drive.
Or that part of the construction would require, because the front part is paved.
Okay. Sure,
and part of the construction of the back would
The gravel drive wouldn't need to be paved until you start walking, exactly. When you're preparing yourself.
Yeah, to additional property built out.
Right. I think that's great. Thank you.
Right. And just so you know, I'm an attorney as well. And I have a deposition in Ohio on the day of the next meeting, so I'll have a representative here, but I will be here. So I just want to let you know that ahead of time. Not because I don't want to be, but you know, that I have to, you know, do my attorney job.
I do want to, have any opposition come from the neighbors? I mean,
we haven't posted it yet.
Okay. What
will happen now for both of these, in fact, is that we'll need to run an ad. Properties be posted. So if there's going to be opposition, that'll come to public hearing.
Okay, right.
That'll be next month. That'll be next hearing.
Yes.
Okay. All that's going to be in the time.
Correct.
Right.
Thanks.
And
Ms. Honey,
if I may address what you were asking earlier, the question was whether or not the rezoning would affect the fee schedule is set up the way that a rezoning is happening is from ag to R1.
About the applicants, Rodriac de Los Angeles. Fuentes Vargas, is that somebody with five names, or is that two people?
Well, the Hispanic names, they usually have like affination.
Oh,
so it's
okay.
Maria de Los Angeles, Fuentes Vargas.
Okay. And then the Fuentes partner is Humberto, that's her husband or whatever, right? Same address.
Yeah, that's what they put.
Okay.
And they, we've done checks on both of them, is that correct?
No, it's listed under Maria, okay. So we ran the background check on her. And they do, I mean, she does live in their account, so.
Great.
Okay. More questions?
Next item is the service delivery strategy, SDS Form 2s. I hope all of you have had an opportunity to look through the Form 2s that we have agreed with Barrow County on, which are all the Form 2s with the exception of water and sewer service delivery area, as well as road maintenance. Is there any question on Form 2s?
And we need to approve those Tuesday.
Yes.
With the exception of the two.
I mean, I think you're really happy with that too. So, you just gave it to me now. I found it.
That's a big book, isn't it?
It's a big book. Well, I mean, you had to do it first.
Well, he went to a couple of meetings.
The big challenge, and correct me if I'm wrong, the big challenge with this is that we really don't have an awful lot of influence on this. Winder has the majority of the population, and so even if we disagreed with it, they're going to do it.
Well, there's a couple pieces that we do have to come to agreement with Barrow County on, and that has to do with the service area, water and sewer.
Yeah.
There's intergovernmental agreement on capacity at the sewer plant. There's going to have to be an IGA on water, and then road maintenance. So
I mean, that's still going to be discussed to be followed up on.
There's a mediation. Right. He got an email this afternoon. Winder and Barrow have agreed on a mediation date of November 12th. So all the smaller cities, the remaining issues, which would include us, will be resolved at that November 12th mediation with the same judge.
So if I understand this correctly, we're disputing some of the boundaries they have of water and sewer, or
it's not really with regard to the boundaries of the service area, there's not really a dispute. There's an issue about which maps are the effective maps, but at least up until this point, there hasn't been a dispute about what the area ought to be. The primary issues of potential dispute that the city and the county, this city and the county, haven't agreed on, have to do with the IGA with regard to the sewer plant, a water contract that's been in existence for a while, and then the road maintenance for the city, that's the road inside the city.
Some of it in the water and sewer overlay, and that's a little bit clearer. Okay.
Any other questions? The next item on the agenda is the ballpark ordinance. It's in your packet, and I know there's been some questions raised about the current ordinance. So I'll open that up for discussion.
Chief, did you have input on this?
I did. Currently, the way our ordinance reads, it refers back to the Georgia state law as far as the requirements for the golf carts. And it falls under 40-6-330.1. It's basically a grandfather clause because our ordinance was enacted prior to 2012. The ordinance that we have for our golf carts was enacted in 2004. And basically it stipulates the grandfather clause in certain areas that the state law reads now. It doesn't lessen the safety issues with the golf carts, just the requirements, the equipment required on, with the exception to the seat belts. The seat belts were changed by hip restraints and hand holds. is basically the bars on the side for the golf cart, and then you've got the handholds up high as well. One of the things that I did want to address that prior to doing this, the city has a requirement under Georgia State Law 40-6-331 as far as designating an area of operation for the personal transportation vehicles, and that would be signage within the state routes that come in to the city limits. It would be required to be signed, 24x24 signs indicating such operation, and there would have to be areas that would be set up for crossings on certain roads, such as state routes or Atlanta Highway or whatever.
Was Atlanta Highway a state road anymore?
It is the Georgia 8 alternate. The actual state route had, when it moved to 316, the original state route, it moved out there as well, Georgia 316 and Georgia 8. The city, it's my understanding that the city is now responsible for Atlanta Highway because it has become a city street as opposed to the way it used to be, US 29 and Georgia 8. So it's our street now, as it's named Atlanta Highway, not a state route, with the exception of the Z from Jefferson Street to Bethlehem Road, which is a...
It's 211.
It's Georgia 211 from there. But it's just a short trek of that is a state route, basically from Jefferson to Bethlehem Road. But we would be required to put that sign postage up, not just letting the people know that it would be, the golf carts would be being driven, but also there would have to be posted areas for them to cross major highways, and they have to stay within those boundaries. You can't just cross wherever you want to. It's a designated crossing area that's dictated by state law.
So we could actually put one at 8th Street.
8th Street, or my suggestion is either 8th Street or Mulberry. Right there as you come off of Broad.
But, you know, number one, if someone wants to go over and pick up a pizza or
correct,
go to Texaco or something like that.
Yeah.
The only way to get to that strip of shopping,
correct,
is via the 8th Street
crossing. Right. I would suggest that we have more than one.
I think we should have the three, the Broad, 8th, and Mulberry.
Right.
I mean, people come off the price, they run off to Mulberry, we don't want to restrict them, have to go down the highway anymore than going.
I wouldn't,
the same way
I wouldn't recommend Dooley Town or Jefferson Street.
I totally agree.
I'm great.
All the traffic light.
The traffic light at Jefferson,
correct,
is a safe crossing for these types of vehicles.
Yes.
And so we would include that. Is that correct?
Yes. Yeah. As far as the licensing fee, it is governed under this as well, and it's a one-time, we have a one-time fee that's in our ordinance. I believe it's $10 for people that reside within the city. And I think it was listed at, what, 60 for residents outside the city.
Okay, I want to discuss that.
Well, there's a state law on,
yeah,
okay,
on that as well. And it's basically the state law says that it's once every 5 years, a fee not to exceed $15.
Okay.
And that's for anybody. That's not just for residents. It's also for anybody that wishes to operate their golf cart, whether they would transport it in on a trailer to the city. We can't say they can drive it from their house in the county because the county ordinances may not allow that. But we're not responsible for or liable for any of that just because they get registered to operate their golf cart.
An example is there's a business owner on Railroad Street that has golf carts
Yes.
And he lives outside of the city limits.
Right.
So we should not charge him $60 a year to do that.
Now that the according to the subsection B of this, it says operate within the boundaries at least once every 5 years for a fee not to exceed $15.
I have an issue with the fee for the county residents being different.
That's what we're saying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we're going to change it all to 10?
We have that option.
Okay.
That's my thing also.
Yeah. I was just thinking about the guy. There's certain neighborhoods here in the state on that are, you know, they're split.
Now,
let me just bring something up. Michelle pointed out to me that the $10 doesn't cover the cost of the materials. Is that correct?
No.
It's just one thing that we have to take into consideration is the cost of the material plus the labor that's going into it.
I had 100 decals fixed, which consists of two, one for each side of the golf cart, with a permit number listed on there, and for those it's $209
for the decals. Which is how much for two of them? I know you did the
math. $1.63 a piece. So it's what?
Yeah.
$3.86.
Okay. Was there something that precipitated us getting on board with the registration of the golf carts? Was there an accident or
no?
Was it just us?
Actually, it was because
it's been 14 years. I mean, you know.
But we had an ordinance and we weren't in compliance with it.
Okay.
We got lots of ordinances. We have learned that we have not instituted, and it's time to step up and do our ordinances.
It's kind of like state laws. There are a lot of state laws and ordinances that never get used. Like you can't tie your horse up to the corner and leave it on the
sidewalk. But on the sidewalk used to be one of the.
Nobody's riding horses anymore, but it's still on the book.
One of the things that I saw in our ordinance was that it specified that it has to be on paved trails.
And yeah. It can be.
Can you, between now and Tuesday, can you double check that? Because I believe that I saw that.
It was in the ordinances. It referred to paved and unpaved as far as when it is talking about the walking paths in the park as opposed to the road. And the biggest thing is the addressing was the fee and the signage, and then of course the inspection. Basically, our inspection is just a basic inspection to make sure you got headlamps, and I've attached that in your packet on the back.
So we're going to kind of adopt this one.
Yes. And it's in compliance with 40-6-330.1,
okay,
which is the grandfather clause, because our ordinance was prior to 2012, which exempts the seat belts. It's not saying that you can't have seat belts, but it's not making it a requirement.
We have no golf carts out.
You can get them out.
We have somebody in the room that has seat belts.
I think it was yours we looked at had seat belts on.
Yeah, he's the only person.
You can get them out.
But it's
not a requirement.
Yeah.
It would be if it was enacted after 2000.
It will be changed to ride my golf cart.
But I definitely think that it's a good idea, especially with kids. You know, if you're riding a child around, then it's not going to protect you when a car hits you. I'm not saying that, but it prevents a child from toppling out.
Hey, TV.
Yeah.
Can they drive those on the Gator or ATV? Are they allowed?
That's in the definition of PTV, right?
No.
No, it's not, because it will depend on the CC.